Hi guys, welcome back to Too Cool for Middle School. Today I just wanted to go through how I taught a unit in our textbook on horror. At my school, we have the HMH curriculum for 8th grade English, and the second unit is called The Thrill of Horror. And it has quite a few pieces in there. I ended up only using 3. We were kind of running short on time, so it wasn't a real long unit. I mean, it did last almost a month. It does take a while to get through everything, but the 3 stories that we did were The Outsider, The Telltale Heart, and The Monkey's Paw. So I just wanted to share a little bit of insight with you on those 3 stories. We've been talking about this stuff over on Instagram, just on Instagram stories, and a lot of you asked for me to just put it in a format that's gonna stay here so you can come back and reference it. So that's what we're doing today. I'm gonna start off by saying that I am not an expert in horror at all. I read a lot of books and I've always read a lot, but I'm a historian, so I mostly read history books, and I read a lot of historical fiction. I'm like recently getting more into Poe, but I feel like a lot of English teachers like know tons and tons about Edgar Allan Poe and about all these like creepy stories, and a lot of people are really into all of that, and I'm just not somebody who is, so there may be a lot of things that people could add to this video. So if you have other insights to share, please add those below. This is just how I taught these 3 stories. So The Outsider is a really interesting short story that I had never read before it was in our textbook. And basically what happens in this story is that you have a guy who's been in a crypt for we don't even know how long. He doesn't remember his family, he doesn't remember who raised him, he's never seen himself, and he climbs and climbs and climbs to get out of the castle one day because he wants to see the moon, and he opens the door and he thinks that he's gonna be way high up in the castle, but he's actually at the ground level and he sees all of these slabs of concrete sticking up out of the ground. So he goes for a walk and he finds this other castle, and it says the moat has been filled in. There's no longer a moat, and there's like strange sounds coming from the castle, and so he realizes that it's a party, and he goes in through the window, and all of a sudden everyone starts screaming and running and fleeing, and he's like, oh my gosh, there's a monster here, what am I gonna do? And he's walking around in the house and he sees this like golden arch, and he sees this hideous dead monster, and he doesn't know what to do, and he like steps back, but then he like reaches for it, and then he realizes that he is touching a reflection and he has been dead the whole time. So then once he realizes that he is dead, he flies around with ghosts, and he's not able to get back into like the crypt, but he's not too upset about it. He just now is like a spirit and flies around with ghosts. And for students, it's really hard for them to get to this point where they understand it, because he's like the nerdiest ghost ever. And he uses so many allusions and such flowery, ornate vocabulary that it can be really hard to like wade through that and figure out what's actually happening in the story. So I have them read it and they are inevitably very confused. And so I use this story just as an opportunity to go through vocabulary words and use them to unlock the meaning of the story. So I have a unit on Teachers Pay Teachers actually with all of the strange vocabulary that I could find in the story. It's over 100 words, and I have 4 classes of like 35 kids. So for me, that was kind of cool because it works out that every single student gets their own word. And I had them look up that word, draw it in a way on like a half sheet of paper that looked like what the word meant. They included the definition and then they included the sentence where it appears in the story. They didn't have to come up with a new sentence, because what I wanted was for them to apply it to that sentence and figure out now what that sentence means if they know the word pinnacle or grotesque or whatever. I gave them a day and a half or so to work on those, and then the next day they came back and they had to walk around the room and show each other their different words and explain to other people what their word meant and how it helped them to understand that sentence in the story. So we did that for a while, and then we reread the story with a little bit better understanding of some of those vocabulary words. And then I just had them list the 5 most important things that happened in the story with a partner. And a lot of them struggled with that too. They couldn't really pinpoint what was happening in the story. So I did eventually have to go through the text really closely with them and read it out loud. It's kind of fun to read out loud because this guy is such a nerd. He's just Casper the nerdy ghost. And so he's very dramatic and everything that he says is just kind of overly explained. And so once we kind of realized that about the character and I kind of read it in sort of just a comical way, okay, this guy, he's a little nuts. And he's gonna exaggerate again, and he's gonna be dramatic again, so let's see how he describes this. So I did have to lead them to what the story was about, really. But then once they got it and read through it one more time, they're like, oh, okay, I see what's happening here. And it's really pretty fun to have a complicated story that you can eventually unlock and then go back and look at it with new eyes and understand what you're reading. So with that one, we really focused mostly on vocabulary. Now, like I said, I don't really read horror. I've never read anything else by H.P. Lovecraft, and he's the author of this story. I recently found out that he's super racist, or he's dead now, but was super racist, and there's lots and lots of evidence to show that he was very white supremacist-y. So that makes me question whether I want to use that story again next year. The story itself is fantastic, meaning that it's not about real things. It's a ghost story, and it's kind of a funny ghost story, and it's not a vehicle for his views about anything. But this seems to be a conversation that we have all the time. What do we do with great art by great a-holes? Especially when they're super, super racist. So, I'm not sure about continuing to use that story. I'm questioning it, but it's so really, really fun to read, I have to admit. But maybe there's a different author who has a story that's kind of similar that we could use the same techniques with that is not super racist. So I don't know. Again, I just don't know a ton about the horror genre, so I don't have all of these other stories. In my mind ready to pull from like I do with a lot of other genres. So I'm just not sure. If you guys know of any other ones, let me know, because I did like that style of writing. I thought it was really interesting, and I like that it's kind of turns at the end, and it's a little sixth sense-y, so I don't know. So after teaching that story, they were more open to horror and more open to things written in the mid-1800s, because at first they were so put off by that language, but then once they started to realize that they could understand it if they knew what those words meant and if they just ignored a phrase or two every so often that didn't really get in the way of the meaning of the whole story, then they could figure out what was happening. So they had a little bit more confidence going into The Telltale Heart by Edgar Allan Poe. Not a wonderful person either, but his life is really interesting, actually. Definitely an alcoholic and a gambler, and didn't he marry his cousin when she was 13 or something? So everyone is problematic. So the process for The Telltale Heart was a little bit similar, where because he uses all these words like hearken and orbs and whatever, all of these kind of old English words and all of these dashes in his writing, and it's a little bit tough to get a hold of. But I kind of walked them through it again, and we realized that he's telling us over and over, he's not crazy, he's not crazy, he's not crazy, I'm not mad. So then I'm like, okay, as we read through this story, you decide for yourself, is he mad or not? I'm like, what really is the sound? Is it his conscience? Is it his own heart beating? What is this? So it's left up to interpretation, and that's kind of fun for 8th graders. There are also some really spooky versions of this story on YouTube. They're animated versions. There used to be this really good one on Netflix called Extraordinary Tales, and it's not there anymore. That's one thing I hate about using things from Netflix in my classroom, because this happens every single time. When I go back the next year to use it, it's not there. So I don't know where else you can find Extraordinary Tales, but that one is pretty cool too. And comparing a written version of something and then a film version of something is one of our standards, so that's always kind of fun to do. Another thing that's in our standards is dashes, and Edgar Allan Poe uses a lot of dashes in The Telltale Heart, and so it's a good way to kind of study that and see like the jerkiness of his thought process and how you would incorporate those to show like somebody's kind of like inner monologue. There were also a lot of really good videos on TED-Ed about writing suspenseful stories and about Edgar Allan Poe himself. So I'll link all of the things that we watched down below so that you can see those, because we would kind of break it up between like a video and then like going back and looking at the story again. We also used a resource from Teachers Pay Teachers that I will also link down below, and one like activity within the bundle was writing a police report for this situation at this old man's house. So in the story, we get to see through the narrator's view, however unpredictable that is. But to do this assignment, you kind of have to take yourself outside of that. So what if you were the police officer who just showed up after getting a call from the neighbors? What would you have thought about this guy? Because he says over and over, like, I was so great with the police, they wouldn't have suspected anything. I invited them in, I showed them around, I gave them some tea, had them sit down. He thinks he was doing a great job, but what do you think the police really would have seen? So it's kind of fun for them to like fill out this police report from that perspective. Like, would you have believed this guy? Would you have thought that he was creepy? Would you have been suspicious? And then what would you have gotten like from interviewing him, and what evidence would you have taken from the crime scene? And then they also do a like a mugshot. So it doesn't say anything in the story about what he looked like, so they have to come up with that on their own. Some say that the narrator's actually a female, some say that he's old, some say that he's young, some say that he, you know, looks really creepy and weird because the old man couldn't see very well anyway. He has like glaucoma in one of his eyes, you know. And then the other ones were like, no, because he would have had to like seem normal in order to get hired, so maybe he looked really normal but then he just like snapped. So they have different interpretations of it, which is kind of fun. And then that is like a pre-activity for their writing, and I have them write either a prologue or an epilogue. I think this came from that bundle as well, this idea. And so they either have to write something that came before this, like maybe it explains what his childhood was like, or like how he got this job, or why he hates glaucoma eyes so much, or whatever. Or it could be an epilogue, like what happens after he's arrested. Maybe he breaks out of jail, I don't know. Like, it could be anything as long as it continues the story and it's still in the narrator's perspective. And in their story, they also have to use dashes at least 3 times just to practice using that form of punctuation. It's kind of hard to work that in anywhere else. It just had to be a page or so. They were just due, actually. I need to grade all of those this weekend, see how they turned out. In the past, they've been super, super creepy. Like, I've had kids read them out loud and it was like, ooh, my goodness, you guys are way more disturbed than I thought. I also had them include an element of foreshadowing in their story somewhere, and if it was like a prologue, they could foreshadow something that happens in The Telltale Heart, or if it's an epilogue, I don't know, it's kind of up to them. I'm not sure what they did yet. But this is probably the only narrative writing we're gonna do. We won't do a whole lot more. Once they get into 8th grade and high school, the emphasis on the standards is more like argumentative writing and informational writing. But there are some kids who just love narrative writing and they really want an opportunity to kind of show off what they can do. And for those who have trouble like constructing an entire setting themselves and coming up with the characters and the plot and everything, this at least gives them like a framework and something to work with, so it's a little bit easier to come up with your own story based on what you read. And I have them kind of do their best to copy or mimic Edgar Allan Poe's style, just to give them something to work with. So that's kind of fun. And then the other really fun thing that we do on Halloween, and I have videos about how to do this, but we do a Telltale Heart escape room. It's from Read It, Write It, Learn It's Teachers Pay Teachers store, and that's really fun. And it's mostly based on vocabulary as well. Like that's kind of how you get most of your clues. And then there's like a decoder ring thing and you have to do that to figure out where the next clue is. And then you gotta go find it and then you bring it back. And I have them do it in groups and then it's like a race, like whichever group finds the old man's beating heart first, they like win candy since it's Halloween, you know? So that's really fun to do. And a lot of the kids were like, can we do an escape room for every single story we read? I was like, ugh. They take forever to set up and they get a little bit wild, but they really did like it. So for Telltale Heart, that's great. And then we went into The Monkey's Paw. This is another one that's like really hard to understand at first, but once you break it down, once you kind of work through some of those Britishisms, then it becomes a little bit easier to understand. So this one is maybe my favorite one to teach because I think as a story, it's actually the simplest. I mean, I had read The Telltale Heart in high school, of course, but the other two I had not read. I had not read The Outsider or Monkey's Paw, but this one I feel like is actually the easiest to latch onto, just with like basic literary skills. So as we went through this one, I told them that our focus was on theme and symbols. Like that's all we really care about. The way that he describes everything is very British. The way that the people speak is very British, and sometimes it's hard for us to understand, but you know, I can explain a few things to you and just keep going. Just keep looking for theme and just keep looking for symbols. And it's almost a very stereotypical story. So as we started reading, it's like, okay, they live in this house out in the middle of nowhere. The road is difficult to travel. It's hard to get there, kind of like no one could hear you if you scream type of a house. And we're like, of course. Right, of course. That's how all of these horror stories start out with. And like for me, because I'm a historian, I'm always looking at like the authors and the date and the context this was written in. So W.W. Jacobs writes a little bit after like Edgar Allan Poe and when this like Gothic style was really popular. So he is almost like, I wouldn't say like making fun of it, but he's using this kind of like well-established horror genre as a vehicle for something else. At least that's like my reading of it. So I think he uses these like very kind of stereotypical tropes to help us like get into the story. So house in the middle of nowhere, there are three people in the family. There's the mom, the dad, and the son. An old friend drops by on a rainy evening. Like, of course he does, you know? And so here's where I think this gets interesting, that nothing in this story is by accident. Every single word and every single detail leads us to the theme. So this takes place in England, and their old friend that visits was a sergeant major in the British Army, and he's been stationed in India for the past 21 years. So we also watched a video about British imperialism and the Indian empires, you know, that tried to keep the British out. But we talked about what colonialism is and why do you colonize a place? What do you do once you're there? And I have a lot of students from India actually, and so we talked about one of the things that the United States and India has in common is that we're both colonized by the British and we both kicked them out using real different methods, but we did have that in common. So I had them keep that like historical background information just like in their mind, just you know that that is a big part of the setting. And then of course this like bewitched item that Sergeant Major Morris has in his pocket is a monkey's paw. And then like after we've read it, we consider whether like, do you think that he came over just to give it, like just to make them want it, or do you think he was really trying to get rid of it when he threw it in the fire? Do you think he knew that they were gonna take it out? So anyway, this monkey's paw gives you three wishes. Again, very common in stories. So this is kind of like a horror story slash like fairy tale slash fable. I also showed them videos of, they're really funny. If you find them on YouTube, I'll link it, but just monkeys like stealing things from people on vacation, because that's what monkey's paws do, right? They're very quick. They take stuff, they take all these things that don't belong to them, and that's just their, what they do with their hands. So we're like, okay, let's keep that in mind as well. There's a reason that this thing that they have is a monkey's paw, and that's gonna relate to the theme. So then part two of the story gets like real dark real quick. I have them make a chart of the three wishes and the three consequences. So they wish for 200 pounds, then the son dies in a factory accident at work, and then the company gives the parents 200 pounds compensation. Then they wish that he was alive again, but they don't specify like pre-accident. So his mangled body rises up from the graveyard 2 miles away and marches over to the house and bangs on the door. And then the dad is the only one who saw the body, so he knows like what his wife would see when she opens the door. So he like frantically makes a third wish, and we're like, okay, he's not gonna be like thinking clearly, because they're like, well, why didn't he just wish for this specific thing so there's not a loophole and da da da. Like, okay, well, he's frantically trying to make a wish before his wife can unbolt the door and open it, and we don't know what the third wish is. He doesn't tell us. All we know is that the knocking stops and the wife lets out this long, loud wail, and it really just ends there. So we know the consequence of the third wish, but they have to interpret what that third wish is. And most of them agree that it's, you know, he wished that the son would just be dead again, or just like go back to the grave or whatever. So we're looking for this theme, and I think that the theme has a lot to do with the historical context that the British were in India just taking whatever they wanted. And then you've got this monkey's paw that seems so exotic, something from India, and monkeys just take whatever they want. And so then these three wishes, you're able to just take three things without really doing anything for it, and there are dire consequences. So we're actually still on this story. So next week we're gonna talk about like, do stories ever have like kind of a personal message, like just for you in general? Maybe the theme is like, be careful what you wish for, but then maybe this story is also like speaking to society in general at this time in England. I tried to find more information about, what's his name, W.W. Jacobs. All I could find out is that he was a comedy writer, and I guess he wrote a lot of like humor stories, but then his most famous one was The Monkey's Paw, and this is this scary story that really took off. And it's really not so much scary, I don't think, as just like suspenseful and really like a fable or kind of like a fairy tale, a very dark fairy tale. So then we talked about the like fine line between humor and horror, and we referenced back to The Outsider, which once you understand it, it's actually pretty funny. You've got this funny nerdy ghost who doesn't realize he's dead, and then he flies around with other ghosts at the end. Like, it's kind of funny. And then really, like, you could interpret The Telltale Heart as like, it's a little bit funny too. The animated versions that we watched of the story like have an element of humor to them. And then it really makes sense that The Monkey's Paw was written by a comedy writer. So we look at Jordan Peele and John Krasinski, who both, you know, had success in comedy and then turned to horror movies. So Jordan Peele, of course, did Get Out and Us, and then John Krasinski did The Quiet Place. And I hate horror movies. I do not enjoy watching horror movies, but I loved all three of those because they were just done in such a smart way. So we watched interviews of both of them talking about kind of like the fine line between humor and horror, and the ways that if you're a good comedy writer, you could turn that into being a good horror writer or suspense or mystery writer, because the format is similar. You just kind of have like a different mood and tone and end game, but it's really interesting. And then I also had my students just like, it's just kind of like a scavenger hunt in general. I'm like, okay, if you can find one more connection between Jordan Peele and our unit, I'll give you some of my son's Halloween candy. And they're like, well, can you give us anything more specific? And I'm like, nope, when you know, you will know. So they would like come up to me and ask me like, is it this? I'd be like, nope. If you really had it, you would know that you have it. So a couple kids did eventually get it, because Jordan Peele's production company is called Monkey's Paw Productions. And I would love to find a video somewhere of him like explaining why that was the name of his company. Maybe there's one out there. If I find one, I'll link it below. So I just thought that that was interesting. Like, that was just another kind of fun layer to put on this horror unit. Oh, the other like very short thing that we did as well is on actual Halloween, because this year we did the escape room the day before Halloween because I had like a longer amount of time per class with my students, and then Halloween was a little bit shorter. So I read them this book called Mary Who Wrote Frankenstein, and it's this like beautifully illustrated children's book about Mary Shelley. And I played like spooky music in the background while I read it. That was really fun. And then we watched another, I think, TED Ed video about Mary Shelley. So we didn't read Frankenstein. There's like a poem about Frankenstein in our textbook, and that would have been the perfect time to go into that. It's just that I was trying to like wrap it up. So if we go a little bit faster next year, then I would do that poem, I guess. And then I bought Frankenstein for myself because I never actually had to read that. Like, we mentioned it in a lot of my like history classes and just like because it's so influential, but I've never actually read it from start to finish. I'm sure I've read like excerpts and stuff. So I bought that for myself because I'm like, I just think it's so interesting that this like 18-year-old girl wrote this story that influences so much today. And one of the videos that we watched, you know, talks about how like because her mother died of complications having her, and then she had like maybe 3 miscarriages, that like part of the theme of Frankenstein is how like birth is creative and destructive at the same time. So it's so interesting that a female, you know, we finally get to read a female horror author. So I'm interested to read that for myself. I'll definitely have it read between now and next year, and maybe we'll pull in more Frankenstein stuff so that we have more Mary Shelley, and maybe there are horror writers from somewhere besides America and England. I mean, I know that like the genre itself was just really popular at that time in those two places, and so it's like easy to pull things and compare them all. And I feel like this is one of the only times during our year that we read anything that is quite old, you know, from the 1800s. Seems like a lot of the other stuff we do is a little bit newer. So it's just kind of nice to give them those tools to be able to break into classic literature when it seems so impenetrable, and you're like, how does anyone ever understand this? But just to give them those tools and then see that they do get it by the end, I think is something valuable to give to them. So yeah, we're actually wrapping up the Monkey's Paw. This is a 3-day weekend, and then when we get back, we'll finish it next week. Next, we're going into Industrial Revolution Literature Circles, and I do have another whole video about that that I can link below as well. This will be the second year doing those, so I am excited. We're gonna do some historical context stuff going into that, and yeah. So anyway, if you have any other insights into any of those stories or suggestions for other short stories that we could use in this unit next year, please let me know. I became a fan of horror and like gothic writing because of this unit. I really never cared about it before, but now I think, you know, I just really like watching my students like get creeped out and like get scared from a story. Like, I just think that's really, really fun. So as a teacher, it pleases me a lot. Anyway, thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in my next video. Bye.